Hey, well, welcome. Hello, and welcome to this session of Open Education Champions. Open Education Champions is a chance to talk to advocates and actors, which is why we are talking to a very important and well-known Open Education Champion. Today, we would like to discuss the importance of open education, share our experiences in facilitating the creation of more open educational resources, of course, always with the role of librarians in mind. And that's why we have a very important guest, a special guest today, which is Robert Schuur. He is a professor of open educational resources. Did I say that right, Robert?
Yes. Yeah. The Dutch term is lector.
Lector.
I think it is when you are a professor at a university of applied sciences, and that's where I'm affiliated at the Fontys University of Applied Sciences, and I'm placed in Eindhoven. Fontys is the largest university of applied sciences in southern part of the Netherlands, which has three main campuses in three mm-hmm. different cities and some small campuses in other cities also. But I'm located in the heart of the Silicon Valley of the Netherlands, Eindhoven. So,
well, we would love to welcome you. We are very happy that you're here today. My name is Marjan Groenouwe. I will be conducting the interview with you today. I am an information specialist at Utrecht University, just getting started in the whole field of open education. So I find it very interesting that I can talk to you today, ask you more about your experiences with open education in the last 15 years. And let's get started. We're very happy to have you. Could you tell me a bit more, just to get started, how did you get involved in open education?
Well, that's just, as you said, 15 years ago in 2006, I was working at the Open University in the Netherlands. And at that time, the then leading dean of the university, Professor Fred Mulder, had the idea of publishing open education resources as an experiment. We called there was a project defined, OpenER, opener, so more than open, that's more than open in Dutch. Mm-hmm. And he asked me if I wanted to be the project leader of the project. So that's how I got involved in open. And yeah, I was from the first moment, it appealed to me. It was something where I could put my heart into it. And I've really thought about this. I thought, well, why am I so passionate about this topic? And after a bit of self-analysis, I think it's because of my mother. Because my mother is, she died 8 years ago. Yeah, she was 88 years, so it was...
Sorry to hear that, but still.
Yeah, but in her youth, she was born in the former colony of the Netherlands in Indonesia, which was then a colony of the Netherlands. And well, at the time she got to secondary education, the war there was a war with Japan and she didn't have the opportunity to really study in higher education and not in secondary education and also not in higher education and she had the brains for it. So I thought, well, what if at that time open education resources were around? Then mm-hmm. she could have an opportunity to still develop herself. And then I realized, well, at this moment there are still many people like my mother then. So that's the origin of my passion, I think. So I didn't realize it when Fred asked me to do this, but I think there is a lot to gain in this, not only for us in the Netherlands, but also in the Global South, where access to high quality learning materials can make the difference between living in poverty or making something of your life, and the gaining of knowledge. And therefore, I find this movement so important.
So
I want to add my piece to it.
It is like something that was close to your heart from the start.
Yes.
I do have to say that I recognize that, because I became involved only this year in open education, but it was something that I was like, oh, this is something I can be passionate about. I want to share with other people. I want to learn more about it, yeah. Become involved. Is the Open Your Yard project still ongoing, or is that?
No, it was a project for 2 years. So from 2006 to 2008. So we published courses at the OU about, it was between 4 and 25 study hours, which people could study for themselves. Some courses had the opportunity to take an exam, and therefore they had to pay €50 to do this. And several dozens of people have done that. And it was meant to for lifelong learners. That was the target group, because as you know, maybe the OU in NL. OUNL is that's the target group for the Open University in the Netherlands, and this gave people who are interested in taking a course, a program at the OUNL, a paid program, an official program, to see if this was something for them.
I actually studied at Open University.
Okay.
Yeah. 10 years ago, but still, I know the benefits of Open University. It is great. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then therefore, that was the aim of those courses. But when you publish this course with this aim, you see happening that these courses were used for many other occasions also, which was fine with us, of course.
Yes.
So we did a lot of research around it to find out what are the effects, what could be the advantages for the OUNL. What could be the advantage for the Netherlands in knowledge evolution, etc. And we learned a lot from the project. But it ended in 2008, and then I became involved in the national program BeekieWise. So that was actually the first national program in the world where the government had taken the initiative to develop a platform in this case for sharing and reusing open education resources, initially meant for all educational sectors, so from primary education to universities. In practice, it landed mostly in the primary and secondary education.
But BeekieWise is still an ongoing project, isn't it?
It was a project for 5 years, or a program for 5 years, and I was a project leader of one of the work packages in this program. And after that, it became a service from KennisNet, which is the counterpart of Surf, but then for the primary and secondary education. And they are still developing on it. So this platform is still in use and still being used. By mainly teachers from primary and secondary education, but also from higher education institutions. I was 4 years ago, I got involved in a project in Fontys. Fontys was a project leader, and where all 17 universities of applied sciences in Netherlands, which are offering a bachelor nursing program, were working together to create share those learning materials for this program, and collaborate in a professional community around that. And I was involved, and I'm still involved in setting this up and evolve this. This is a very rich project, and we choose BeekieWise to publish this learning material. So there are, I think, now 1,400 resources published from this project, and they are all available in BeekieWise.
And BeekieWise has been up and running for 10 years then now in the Netherlands?
Yes, the first version, but it was all, the initial version was published 2010, and it is still going on and on, and undergone a lot of improvements and changes, of course, in the last years, but it's still going on. And KennisNet considers it one of its strategic services, so they will keep investing in it.
Wow. You just mentioned briefly that you did research on the benefits of OER from the start of your career when you were involved in OpenER. Could you tell us a bit more about that research and what it
Well, the majority of this research I've done in the last 7-8 years, because it was part of the chair I'm currently heading, and it was targeted mostly on the higher education sector in the Netherlands. So I'm interested in how can we make sure that how can we reach the early and late majority of teachers are getting involved in sharing and reusing learning materials. So they are available, it is possible, but it is not still not mainstream. It is not, when you ask an average teacher in a university or in a university of applied sciences about OER and about are you involved in it, then I think the majority of the teachers will say from, well, I've heard about it, but I'm not involved in it. And there are
that's what they say to me. That's a lot of work. Why should I get involved?
yeah, that is one of the barriers. So I studied what are the barriers, and I'm not the only one doing this research. This kind of research is done worldwide, and they all give the same barriers. So the barriers: lack of time, fear for breaching copyright. Fear of I'm not sure about the quality of the resources. Maybe there is a mistake in it, and that's bad for my career. So I'm hesitating to publish the materials. What's in it for me? Why should I do it? So what am I gaining? Therefore, I find this recognition and rewarding initiative. And then expanding that to open education is so important, because then you can make a career in publishing good learning materials, which is now, especially at research universities, and that was one of the barriers I found in the Netherlands. Every minute I'm involved in education, I'm not involved in research, and that's harming my career. Because that's what I love so much about this whole movement which is behind this recognition and reward, because I think that is necessary for partly answering the what's in it for me question.
Because if you I am talking to a teacher, I want to get them involved, I want to get the vast majority involved, because there are the early adapters and they're already with me and they're already enthusiastic about the whole idea. But I want to get the typical teacher that is skeptical, that says what's in it for me, I want to get that person to cooperate, to be enthusiastic. Yeah. What can you give me for advice? Yeah. What arguments do you think work best with that group?
Now, what are teachers passionate about? That's about teaching. Mm-hmm. When you talk about their topic, about how do you teach it, how do you get your students active, then you see the fire in the light, the fire in the eyes, and then they start talking and talking and talking. But what are the typical conversations you have with teachers about open education resources? Within 1 minute, you are talking about open licenses. And the copyright and those and all those things, and you see this fire, and they are not interested. So my approach is talk about with teachers about the passion about teaching, and what I try to do then is try to find out what is hindering you, what is hindering you in giving the lesson which for you is perfect, and from that information I try to analyze how can I help you with open educational resources. Now, and maybe they say, I want to get my students more active. I don't want to be the teacher sending all the information. I want the students to find the information. Okay, then you are talking about things which I know are called open pedagogy. Activities you can design in your teaching in which you involve students in open educational practices, in using open educational resources, or maybe publishing open educational resources. I found an interesting example of it at your university, at Utrecht. The students, it was a study I never heard of it, dynamic oceanography or so, something.
Wow.
I don't know what this study involves, but the professor teaching this topic last year, he said, well, it had to be done fully online because of COVID-19. He said, well, I don't want to do the same kind of examination as I mostly do. Let's do it another way. And he said to the students, you have to publish Wikipedia articles about topics on this topic. So those students, instead of making an exam, they publish Wikipedia articles, which is not new. This is done on several occasions in the world, but this was the first I came across in the Netherlands. And so, wow, I didn't know this. I didn't know this study, but you see, the teachers are very creative in doing this, and when you point teachers to those opportunities, which open education and the application that is using open education resources or more using the opportunities open platforms or openness can give to you, then you connect to the passion, you connect to how they want to teach and then you also have to talk about copyright and etc. But then they know why they are doing it.
And so you're underlining like the possibilities of co-creation and other types of pedagogy to draw them in, so to speak.
Yeah, and I talked previously about this nursing project. For them, we also did a lot of research around it. Why are the teachers there involved? And we have a lot to do after 4 years still to get all those teachers involved. There's still a lot of work to be done, but the main reason was. It was clear what's in it for them, because they started a whole new program with new topics like e-health and so on, where every university had to develop learning materials, and they had to develop it quickly. So they say, well, why not combine forces and do this? Because that was their basis. They had a program description, which was for all the universities the same. Mm-hmm. They have the same terminology, so learning materials created at our University of Applied Science could also be used in other universities of applied science, because the terminology they agreed upon and the way it should be given, which topic should be in the course, that was agreed. So this is a perfect base to find it. Therefore, I strongly believe in this not publishing materials as a teacher on your own, but publishing learning materials as a member of a community, community of practice from likewise teachers teaching the same topic or the same professional topics. Because they can help you, they can give you the feedback you maybe need, because teachers also hesitate to publish, they are not sure about the quality, but when you give them feedback, they get more sure, and then they are less hesitate to publish it. So that would be my advice: connect to the passion.
Mm-hmm. And you say, if I understand you correctly, that the whole community idea is like it makes it easier to draw teachers in, because they can connect with other teachers, and it would make it easier to share materials if they work within a community.
Well, the advantages of this community is as you mentioned, but it is also advantages, because publishing learning materials is one thing, but after 1 year, 2 years, those learning materials should also be maybe updated, upgraded, or maybe they are outdated and they should be removed. Someone has to do that, and someone has to publish it, and that is something I think that the community could be of value. The community can see, okay, those learning materials, they are a bit outdated, or we are missing certain topics. We are missing. Who wants to create those learning materials, or maybe who has those materials and can share them, and so. But what you see happen is that a lot of those communities, they start, and they start with a project grant mostly from external sources. And then the money is spent, and the project has ended after 1 or 2 years, and then there is no community. So that is one thing I've learned in this nursing project from starting with day one. We said we should build on this community. We should make sure that this community will last after the project money, after the project is done. Now we had the luck that we had two fundings for 1 year to start, and then a follow-up funding for the next 2 years, which was then extended to 2.5 years because of COVID. But after that, 11 of the 17 institutions involved said, okay, we will make a commitment that we will continue this effort for 5 years on our own expenses. So each institution has committed for, I think, 20,000 euros a year to spend hours on this endeavor. And still, there are a lot of issues, and we don't know if this still will be alive. We still don't know. We see that they're still alive, but you have to work very hard to keep it alive and to involve more and more teachers to get a certain critical mass. But it has got us a lot of data, and we are now analyzing a lot of those data from the previous phases to see, okay, what can we learn from this? How we approach this, and what were our results, and what are the lessons learned we can give to the community, to the whole community, open community, to make more of these initiatives where community-based open educational resources will be alive also after the project has ended. That is one of the challenges, because I think there's also maybe a kind of expectations, what you can expect. I mentioned Fred Mulder as the one who got me into this this field in 2006. Fred was also involved in Wikiwise. He was in the steering committee, and at that occasion, it was around 2010, he said, before this whole movement will be mainstream, it will cost 20 years. Now, we are now about halfway, and I think he's right.
Yes.
I think he's right. It will cost, because it is a change of culture, and it is going very slow, and you have to, these changes should occur on all levels. It should occur on the level of the teacher, the support, but also on the level of the policymakers. And
very important step to take.
Yeah, and they should also see their role. They should take their role to, for instance, to make a policy on OER. To have a vision on OER, what it can mean for their institution, and translate that to implementation. Implement that in for instance, like a recognition and reward scheme for making careers, for rewarding teachers who are doing great things in this. This is very complex, but.
Do you see, because I work as a librarian, I used to be a teacher before I was a librarian, and I thought, hey, maybe I could, as a librarian, be like sort of a community manager, because as you said, for teachers, it's hard to maintain the community. And I used to be a teacher, so I know the teachers, and I work at the library now. Do you see like a librarian as a person who could manage a community, who could play an important role in that, or should we leave that to the teachers themselves?
No, I think librarians have an important role in the whole field. One of the barriers which is always mentioned is we lack support. Mm-hmm. As a teacher, I'm not an expert on copyright. Someone has to tell me about this. Someone has to help me with this. Uploading learning materials also means adding metadata. Well, that's something a teacher is not funded, and also is not an expert on it. It's also a skill which is typically available among librarians. So develop processes in which a librarian can take their role in supporting the teachers, because it's teamwork. Librarian is one part. You also need the IT expert, because especially when you develop more advanced digital learning materials like simulations or whatever, that's an IT. There are also ICT issues in it, and where you need an ICT expert to support you. You also need an educational designer designing the digital learning materials so that it is it is sound. Also from a pedagogical point of view, that's a profession in itself, and all in this complete team should be involved.
Yeah, so it's like a complete network.
Each of them has a role also in the community. And what role it is, it can be leading or so. That's, I think, less important. They should play a role. And that's also what you have seen, what we have seen in this nursing project, that they took their role. These librarians took their role to support the teachers in sharing their learning materials.
So also you say like an active librarian that helps in the community, that helps with uploading, that helps with copyright, that helps maybe push for that's also critical for the development of OER.
They can also be very great advocates for OER because teachers
also in policy making. Do you think the librarians have a role in policy making?
Yes, I also think we made last year. We have currently running an innovation program in the Netherlands. We noted the acceleration plan for education innovation of ICT, and there's one. Topic in it about digital open learning materials.
I saw it. I was triggered by that.
Yes, and I'm heading this. They have their own jargon in it. They call it zones, and you have a captain. So I'm the captain of this zone, but actually, you can also call it, it's a project, and I'm the project leader. Mm. And that is last year we created an a vision document, a vision about digital learning materials. So the whole part, not only open materials, but the whole mix of learning materials, open, semi-open, closed, commercial learning materials. We have written some statements about this, and vision statements, what in 2025 should be realized, and also some building blocks how to come to this situation. And then you see there's building blocks are both for the technical point of view, the policy point of view, etc. And one of the authors for this was a librarian. It was head of a librarian. It was a librarian, and we had also of course had the feedback groups and so, and there's also librarians active in it. So
because that's really good to hear. Like, I'm still like discovering what's my role as a librarian in this whole context, but it's good to hear that there are active librarians that actually contribute.
But in the Netherlands, there are both from the research universities and University of Applied Science have this. They work together in UKB and SAB. And under this umbrella, there is a working group, Open Online Education, Librarians Open Online Education. So that is, I don't know if you know about this group.
I do, because I have, of course, applied for the group because I thought I have to see more colleagues that can inspire me to also get involved in activities to support open education
and my own institution. Great job. And they do all those things we mentioned earlier in this interview, advocating, give teachers awareness about what's going on, but also help teachers how to help. They are developing all kinds of resources to help you in. They give workshops about all those topics, and so they are very, very active working group.
Yes. Hey, and you said like the nursing project is now running for a few years. How long has it been running?
It's running since 2017.
Okay, so that's like four or five years now?
4 years now, yeah.
Can you, like, now that this is a longer running project, pinpoint like what are the key benefits of this project for the people that use it? Could you like say, okay, these are like the benefits that we can distinguish that really stand out?
Yeah, several. First are the more usual ones, which you always hear. It is efficient because I can use learning materials which I don't have to create myself. So I save time with it. They learn when they collaborate with each other to develop new learning materials. Those are the regular. But there's also a very one which I wasn't aware of, which also was mentioned many times by participants. It gives them a nice way to look in each other's kitchen. As you said. So it is when you want to see how other institutions are doing their are offering their program, what they are doing for kinds of activities. Before this project came on, you had to make a post. Maybe you didn't know people on that other institution, and now all those barriers were gone. You saw each other. You saw each other live in physical meetings. That was before COVID, or you saw each other before COVID and especially during COVID in online environments, and you could make appointments. You could make, okay, how are you doing? Can we talk a bit further about this? So you could see how other institutions were doing it with no barriers, which was, these participants have mentioned that as one of the big advantages.
Mm-hmm.
And also a better awareness and about quality of learning materials, because it was one of the barriers which teachers always mention. I'm not so sure about the quality, but they ask, okay, what do you mean by quality?
That's what I hear a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, and that, but when you ask, what do you mean about quality? What do you consider good quality? Then it's a kind of implicit feeling. It is, and that is not. Then you can communicate about it. So what we have done, and that was one of the lessons I learned from Wikiwise. We started this project in 2017 with thinking about what is quality for us. So we try to make it as concrete as possible.
Mm-hmm.
to mention criteria these are the requirements your learning material should have before we publish it. And that was one thing where a librarian also put a check on it. Well, one of the things was very clear, it should have Creative Commons license.
Yeah.
Or when you put a link to it, then this link should not be given for error. Or those are the obvious ones. But there are also on more the content. Is it good content, good quality content? And they have managed to make that very concrete to really say this should in it, this should in it, this should be in it, this should be on par, etc. And that gives the teachers also more confidence, because they create learning materials and they can really check. Okay, this is good. So I'm confident about it. So I can share it. It took half a year to make this model. We created a small group, creating the first version of this model, get feedback from the teachers, because it should be not from this whole group, but it should be from all teachers. So this was done several times, and then we created the first version. And one of the, what I consider one of the, also one of the big, is it
benefits
of this project was that that the institutions adopted this quality.
Mm-hmm.
Not only for the materials they share, but also for the materials they wouldn't share. But it became part of their workshops, and teachers who were new and got an introduction program also learned about this quality model. So this quality model is a living thing. Each year it is evaluated, and then maybe some requirements are not so valid anymore, or should be more strongly defined. So it is now in its fourth version, and each year there is a new version based on the experiences with this in the institutions.
Wow, so it's fine-tuned actually along the way, and it gets better and more precise.
Yeah.
Wow, that's so cool. Hey, and you said earlier on in our interview that it was like, we see it as a 20-year project and we're halfway there. We're now like at the 10-year mark. What do you feel needs to be done for open education to really like take hold? Do you see anything like pressing challenges that should be met? Where are we now, and what should be done to get to where we want to go in 10 years' time?
Well, I think I've prepared this question. First, I think the open movement should be more open.
We're not open enough.
No, and what I mean by this is that open education resources has a very strict definition. Yeah? It should be openly available. It should be the five R rights
widely,
etc. Yeah. But for teachers, much more openly available materials without those five R rights are also very interesting. And for instance, like
semi-closed materials, or
it could be semi-closed, but it could also be. Let me give an example. The MOOCs. Mm-hmm. The MOOCs, when they came to rise in 2011, 2012, I was at a conference in the United States then, and there was only there was talks about MOOCs as something which was not open because it had no Creative Commons license. Mm-hmm. It had a very poor didactics, etc. And I thought, well, this is not fair, because first, for teachers, it could be very worthwhile. But for learners, especially, learners don't need this 5R rights because they don't want to. They only want to learn it. So for learners, those 5R rights and this Creative Commons license, they don't need it. They only need this free access to a MOOC, and also for a lot of teachers, they can reuse a MOOC as part of their program, without having the need to adapt it. So they also don't need the 5R rights, and that's what I mean by you should be more open. You should be open push OER in itself, but you should push OER as part of a larger ecosystem where the other parts are also very valuable, although they are not so open.
So we say if we value that you want to share digital learning materials, but they don't necessarily have to be openly licensed for us to be considered valuable. Is that what you're saying?
Like, that's if what I'm saying, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So when I give workshops to teachers and learn them, for instance, to look at Wikivice or look at AD sources, which is more or less the same kind of platform, but then for higher education in the Netherlands, then I also learn them to look for open educational resources or for openly available learning materials, openly accessible learning materials, in other platforms. So for instance, most teachers use Google.
Mm-hmm.
And you can use Google Advanced Search to look for Creative Commons licensed materials. But they can also look, I also pointed to Class Central as for me, the search portal for MOOCs. Because for those teachers, they don't care about if it's open or not open. They want, what do I want to do with those materials? And if they want to adapt it, then they should care about the open license. But if they don't want to adapt it, then they don't care. And that is one part of the more openness. The other part is when teachers want to share, but only within a selected group.
Which they often do.
Support that. Because each teachers already are sharing, only not so open maybe as we like to wish, and maybe it is good that they only keep it in a small community, but it could be, well, a stepping stone towards sharing with the whole world. Mm-hmm. And I think there should be more begrip, more
understanding,
more understanding for this part. And I think that, and I think there is a lot of improvement already, or in the whole world. But I think the overworld comes from this very this very narrow view, and where considered everything which was not as open as the definition of open resource was considered bad. And that is something I think should be done more.
I find that very interesting. So you're actually saying, if you like, facilitate little steps in between. We're not saying you have to share it openly with an open license, but we're saying, okay, you can share it, but we facilitate the steps in between by saying, okay, share it with your peers, share it with a group of teachers. Yeah. That would make the movement gain momentum, because the step from not sharing to sharing completely open is maybe a very large step for teachers to take. And if we put little steps in between, they would be...
Yeah.
Ah, that's very interesting, because yeah. I, you know, as a newbie in open education, the whole Wiley and the 5 R's is like thrown at you with lightning speed. So this is what it has to be. But you're saying we have to focus on a larger group of learning materials, whether they're openly licensed or not.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And another another thing is sustainable business models. What I'm saying is, publishers are seen as evil, and maybe for part they deserve to be seen as evil. But publishers can all they have a lot of experience in parts of this publishing process.
We should incorporate them in the process and
Involve them in the process. Them in the process with a fair role and position for both publishers and content creators. And publishers should be paid for that, of course, but a fair amount and the rights should be openly. So publishers can take a role into collaborating with the public institutions for creating open learning materials. And that part is not research so much yet. I know in the States that David Wiley is doing a lot of work in that area, and he pointed me to this direction also. So I'm inspired by him, in this thing. But I think there is a challenge for the open community, and in the Netherlands we are now taking steps that we try to convince board members to take their role in it and do the negotiations with the publishers on this part. As we were inspired, of course, what has been happening in the last couple of years in the open science movement, where the VSNU then the publishers did the negotiations with the publishers, and not each institution is individual to come to agreements.
Yeah, well, that's very like new, innovative viewpoints that for me, as someone new in open education, has never really thought about that. Because I did think for myself, like what could be necessary for open education to further develop. And we have touched upon that very briefly, but it's the whole recognition and rewards subject of it all. Do you think that's also essential for the further development of open education?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And the last, I see we have to wrap up.
We could talk for an hour.
Yeah, but I think one thing I also want to say, more attention for OER adoption in TVET. And TVET is for technical and vocational education and training. I've done this study a couple of years ago together with a colleague of mine, Ben Jansen, for UNESCO. UNESCO had asked us to do this study. What can open educational resources mean for this area? And that's not higher education. And what we found out was that a lot of research and a lot of efforts are focusing on higher education. Mm-hmm. But especially in the Global South, TVET is much more important. When the World Bank in 2018 has published a report, and they considered not high, high income countries and high income countries, and the not high income countries, which is for most part what we call now the Global South, 90% of it has not high education. Mm-hmm. So when you focus so much on higher education and openness in higher education, then I think the divide between the haves and the have-nots will only be larger instead of be smaller. And you want to be smaller using open education resource. So that is also one challenge I see for the open movement.
For the next 10 years. Well, thank you. I also think we have to wrap it up. We've been talking for a long time now. Thank you so much again for being here, for sharing your thoughts on open education. I found it very informative and inspirational also for my own work. So thank you again. We really look forward to sharing this conversation with the OE community. And I hope to see you again in the Netherlands somewhere.
Yeah, I also thank you for asking me these questions and giving the opportunity to speak out, and I found it very pleasant to do that. And I hope I hope it will get attention.